Let's spend some time talking about the different categories of chemical reactions as it relates to product complexity and energy. So chemical reactions come in several categories. As had been mentioned, living organisms all require energy from their surroundings, from their environment, in order to survive. The sun is the source of most energy on planet Earth. Solar energy can be used by producers or autotrophs in order to synthesize sugars. Now, the term autotroph, auto means self, and troph means feeding. So producers, they're able to generate their own food through sunlight. An example of this would be plants performing photosynthesis. The chemical equation for photosynthesis is that we have our reactants, which are carbon dioxide and water, being converted into our products, which are glucose and oxygen gas. This chemical reaction requires the energy provided by sunlight to be performed. In this way, the organism performing photosynthesis is converting solar energy into chemical energy. Now, the reactants for photosynthesis, carbon dioxide and water, these are very small, very simple molecules, and they do not have a lot of stored energy. But glucose, C6H12O6, we see is a much larger, more complex molecule, and there's a lot of chemical energy stored in glucose. Again, much like gasoline or gunpowder, glucose has potential energy stored within its chemical structure. Now, what about non-photosynthesizing organisms like animals and fungi? Well, we are considered consumers, or heterotrophs. Hetero means other. So we are other feeders. We need to feed on other organisms. We cannot get our energy directly from the sun. For us, energy is acquired from food molecules, much like that glucose we saw in the previous chemical reaction. Now, as we eat food and as we get energy from the food, the energy that we're receiving is either directly or indirectly the product of photosynthesis. So if you're eating an apple, if you're eating a carrot, if you're eating a salad, that energy that you're getting from those items came directly from the plants which were performing photosynthesis. Now, if on the other hand, you're eating a bacon cheeseburger, well, the energy that you're getting from the meat and from the cheese was from those organisms, either eating plant material or eating other animals who had consumed plant material. But eventually it all goes back to photosynthesis as the source of the energy in our food, even if there are a few steps in between. Now, in order for us to get energy out of the food that we eat, this is a chemical reaction known as cellular respiration. The chemical equation for cellular respiration, in some ways, looks very similar to photosynthesis, but it's somewhat flipped or reversed. So in cellular respiration, our reactants will be glucose and oxygen gas, whereas the products will be carbon dioxide and water. So you can see for cellular respiration, the reactants were the products of photosynthesis. And for cellular respiration, its products are the reactants for photosynthesis. These two metabolic pathways, photosynthesis and cellular respiration, they're related to each other, but they are somewhat opposite. In cellular respiration, this chemical reaction releases the energy that had been stored in the sugar. In this way, the organisms power the activity of their cells by releasing the stored chemical energy. Now, there are different ways we can categorize chemical reactions based on the complexity of their products. Chemical reactions will either result in products which are more complex or simpler than the reactants, than the starting molecules. Now, if we have a chemical reaction that results in a larger, more complex product, we call it an anabolic reaction. This is sometimes also referred to as biosynthetic because we're creating complex molecules out of smaller, simpler ones. Dehydration synthesis and photosynthesis are both examples of anabolic reactions. Because the products are more complex, these reactions will require energy, but we'll get to the energy categorization in just a moment here. In contrast, if you have a chemical reaction which breaks something down into smaller, simpler pieces, that is considered to be a catabolic reaction. And in a catabolic reaction, complex molecules are broken into smaller, simpler molecules, and this will result in the release of energy. Hydrolysis and cellular respiration both fall into this category. So when we look at the relationship between anabolic and catabolic reactions, anabolic ones take smaller, simpler molecules and build them into something larger and more complex, but it requires energy to do this. Whereas catabolic reactions take these complex molecules, break them down into smaller, simpler molecules, and release energy in the process. So we had talked about anabolic and catabolic in terms of how complex the products are compared to the reactants. The next pair of terms I'd like to introduce you to are endergonic and exergonic. These are the two main chemical reactions in terms of energy. We use these two terms to discuss chemical reactions which differ in the amount of usable energy before and after the chemical reaction. Remember, because energy is not created or destroyed, the energy that we're talking about is stored either in the reactants or the products as chemical energy before it's then released or made usable. So looking at these two categories, chemical reactions which release energy when they occur are known as exergonic reactions. The energy which is released with the products had been stored in the reactants. The chemical products of an exergonic reaction have less stored energy than the reactants did. The products are also going to be simpler than the reactants were. With hydrolysis, being an example of an exergonic reaction, I would like to briefly diagram the energy difference throughout the course of an exergonic reaction. And so on this chart, we'll have stored energy. Over time. With an exergonic reaction, our reactants they start with a lot of stored energy. After an initial energy investment, they then release their energy. And the products now have less stored energy. And in fact, the energy difference between the reactants and the products, this represents the released energy. This energy can then go on to do work. It's now available or free to be used. Endergonic reactions, on the other hand, are chemical reactions which absorb or require energy when they occur. The energy which is absorbed by the products did not come from the reactants, but had to come from some other source. The chemical products of an endergonic reaction will have more stored energy in them than the reactants did. And that's again because the energy was absorbed from some other source. The products are more complex than the reactants. Dehydration synthesis again, that process of taking individual monomers and connecting them together into a polymer. Dehydration synthesis is an example of an endergonic reaction. So a similar chart for an endergonic reaction, we have our stored energy. Over time. But in this case, our reactants start with a relatively low amount of stored energy. They absorb energy through the course of the chemical reaction, and our products will have more stored energy. And this energy difference between reactants and products, this represents the energy absorbed. Anabolic reactions are always going to be endergonic, whereas catabolic reactions will always be exergonic. Now that we've talked a bit about the different categories of chemical reactions, let's discuss how cells control the chemical reactions which occur within them. See you in the next video.